Namaskar and good evening. Viewers, welcome to the 110th episode of Words of Wisdom, Gyan Ganga. As you know, we have this Sunday episode of Words of Wisdom, Gyan Ganga every Sunday at 8 p.m. on all the social media channels. And on Saturday, we have Earth Gyan Ganga, Economic Words of Wisdom. Yesterday was the 12th episode of Economic Words of Wisdom, Earth Gyan Ganga. I'm happy to share with you the last week's viewership. Cumulative viewership has crossed 150,000. And yesterday's Earth Gyan Ganga viewership has touched 40,000 already within 24 hours. Thank you very much, viewers, for a huge support for our programs. And these programs, as you know, are mentored by Dr. Subramaniam Swami. Today we have a very important topic about the catching the numbers of COVID. As you know, today we touched 28 lakhs total infections and 2.4 lakh new cases today. And this graph has been going down for the last few days. And one team led by Dr. Manindra Agarwal, Professor IIT Kanpur, has been successful in tracing these numbers very accurately. Last week, he had actually predicted that 8th May, the peak will come of the number of cases were 3.9 lakhs and active cases will peak on 13th of May. And almost exactly the same thing has happened. How this thing he has been doing successfully and this model of epidemic forecasting, this is called Sutra model. Sutra is an acronym for Susceptibility Undetected Tested Removed Approach. There have been many different types of models used by people who are in the epidemic forecasting. And the basic model is SIR model, Susceptible, Infective, and the Recovered model. But of course, we have, in case of COVID, we have immunity. So those who are recovered are not susceptible anymore. This is what is assumed. And Dr. Agarwal and his team has come up with this model. In fact, he came up with this model in January. I read it on the Cornell University website. He gave all the details about how this prediction he's been doing. And of course, for a few days, the figures were not so accurate. And he has already given illustration also to show more the data, more the accuracy. He has predicted up models up to 14th of April, 15th of April, last week of April, and the first week of May. And every time more data is being used, more accuracy is also being displayed. And this team led by Dr. Manindra Agarwal has been successful. Let me, though it's for mathematicians and people in the academic world, he needs no introduction. But for other people, let me first give brief introduction of Dr. Manindra Agarwal. He did his B.Tech and Ph.D. in computer science from IIT Kanpur in 1986 and 1991 being doctorate. After graduating at Chennai Mathematical Institute and University of Ulm, Germany, he joined computer science engineering department at IIT Kanpur, my alma mater. I'm proud to be from IIT Kanpur. He joined in 1996. He is currently professor and program director of Technology Innovation Hub in cybersecurity at IIT Kanpur. His research areas are complexity theory, computational number theory, and algebra. He is a recipient of several awards and honors, including Godel Prize, very prestigious in mathematics, Fulkerson Prize, Shanti Shuru Bhatnagar Award, Infosys Prize in mathematics, and Padma Shri title by Government of India. He is Foreign Associate of National Academy of Sciences and Fellow of the World Academy of Sciences, Indian National Science Academy, Indian Academy of Sciences, National Academy of Sciences India, and Indian National Academy of Engineers. Welcome, Dr. Manindra Agarwal, on this show of Words of Wisdom from Virat Hindustan Sangha. So today, we will leave the field to Dr. Agarwal to talk about the Sutra model how exactly he captured the data. There are many questions. In fact, the day we announced this title and the guests, many of the guests, people have been flooding the with messages about interest showing in this program. And so today, the field is open to you. Dr. Subramanian Swamy, our mentor, will join later, and he's here with us. And he will welcome to Dr. Subramanian Swamy. Welcome Jagdish Shetty, my co-host, and Ramesh Swamy from New Jersey. And let us start with Dr. Manindra Agarwal. Once he finishes his description, then Dr. Swamy will have his comments, and then we'll have a question and answer session. Dr. Manindra Agarwal.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Chaturvedi. Could you please share my screen?
Yeah, we have your screen.
So I'm going to go full screen. So as Dr. Chaturvedi mentioned, the whole pandemic mathematical modeling field started by Kermack and McHenry, and they propose what is called SIR model. And these models are actually quite simple and can be explained. There is some technicality like differential equation involved, but they can be explained even without that. What SIR model does is it divides the population into three groups. Susceptible are those who are not yet infected, may get infected in future. Infected are those who are currently infected. And removed are those who were infected in the past and have either recovered or have died.
Professor Agarwal, so, quick, sorry to interrupt you. Can you speak a little bit louder?
Okay, so I will, I hope this is okay.
Yeah, very good.
Excellent. So, as I was saying, that the population is divided into these three groups, susceptible, infected, and removed. And the movement clearly is from susceptible to infected and infected to removed. The what we do is the size of these three groups vary with time. So, we represent their sizes as variables which change with time. So S of T is the size of susceptible group, I of T is size of infected group, and R of T is size of removed group. And for convenience, we represent them as fraction by dividing them by underlying population so that each one is between a 0 and 1. And the sum of the three sizes is always 1. Now, it's easy to say or argue that in any one day, the number of newly infected people that get created is proportional to S times I. That's because the number of connections, so new infection will only happen when a susceptible person meets an infected person. And the number of possible such connections are I times S. And out of those possible connections, some small fraction actually gets infected. And that's the constant of proportionality beta. Similarly, the other equations can be set up. I'm not going into much details of that. And what eventually comes out is there's these three parameters, beta, gamma, and eta. And their values determine the trajectory of the pandemic. Now, how do we know the values of these parameters? Well, traditional method of computing these values is done by epidemiologists. They study the property of the virus in under question. That kind of affects how fast the pandemic is spreading, how quickly people recover. Population dynamics also, that density of population, movement of people, that determines how many of them are meeting each other in a day. And that will impact the value of beta. Healthcare infrastructure will impact the mortality rate, eta, which I have not really talked about. So these parameters really are governed by many biological and non-biological aspects. And epidemiologists study all of them and make a good guess as to what their value is. Now, here is an alternate way of estimating, let's say, one parameter beta. Number of new infections created in a day, let's give it a name, N of T. And N of T is proportional to is beta times SI, and SI replaced by 1 minus R minus T by using that invariant. and I get this equation that I is equal to 1 over beta times n plus I plus R times I. And this, of course, one tells us a linear relationship between these three quantities, I, n, and I plus R times I. Secondly, if we can measure these three quantities, I, n, and R, then we will be able to compute beta, because then we can just plug it into this equation and get the value beta out. Well, the problem is with this approach that it's literally impossible to estimate the value of I, N, or R. I is the currently total infected population. Now, in any pandemic, not all infected people will actually report to a doctor, get tested, and declare to be infected. There will be many who will just carry the infection with them without reporting. Same will be the problem with N. Daily new infections, it's very hard to measure the actual value of N. And same is true with R. So that is the reason why this very simple approach cannot be used to estimate parameter values. And as I said, epidemiologists resort to other methods of estimating these parameter values. And so this is probably, I already said that. Subsequent to SIR model, several new models have been proposed for various types of pandemics. But all of them have essentially the same challenge, that one has to make just guesses of the parameter values, because this variable trajectory, the values of these variables, measuring sizes of different categories, is simply not possible to estimate. Now, that's where we come in, that is our team, and I'll just jump over to the COVID-19 pandemic. COVID-19 pandemic, as everybody knows, has some very interesting properties. One key property is that it has very large number of asymptomatic cases. And that makes the problem of estimating the size of N or size of I even more difficult, because these large number of cases never get reported. So it becomes that even bigger challenge to understand what actually is the number. And now there is another challenge with COVID. This was there earlier also, but it's become more pronounced with COVID. It is that since spread of the pandemic has been controlled with varying degrees of success by various countries, it is the underlying population over which the pandemic is active at any time is not necessarily the entire population of the country or the region we are studying. It actually becomes a much smaller part of it. And so, when you, as I mentioned, that we measure all these variables in terms of fractions, then even the underlying population is hard to estimate, that because that changes with time. And this is an issue that no model has addressed so far. It can be addressed simply, but there is a problem when you try doing it this way. You just make the underlying population also as a variable of time. So P of T is that population of the region over which the pandemic is active at time T. And you define the new parameter rho as to be the ratio of P and P naught. P naught is the total population of the region. So rho will be a parameter whose value is always between 0 and 1. When the pandemic starts, it's close to 0. And eventually, rho keeps on increasing and settles somewhere close to 1. So this parameter is something we introduce, and we call it the reach of the pandemic. It can be modeled easily. The problem is that we have now one more parameter to estimate. We cannot estimate even the earlier parameters. It makes the life more difficult to estimate this one. But there is something very good with COVID-19 pandemic also. It is that we have extensive data available for the first time. Even going to the district level for India, nearly all districts have daily time series of new infections, reported infections, reported deaths available. So that huge amount of data, the question is, can it help in estimating these parameter values? Like I showed you earlier, for SIR model, we can estimate the parameter value beta if we only we knew the sizes of those three groups. So with this large amount of data available, one can ask the same question that, like, is it possible to do something with it? Of course, there are this all these complications one keeps hearing about, underreporting of data, limitations of testing. There are all these complaints that some region is not testing enough, and so on. So all of this combined together make the reported data further away from the actual number. And the question that we asked was that, can the we use reported data in a manner so as to give us the parameter values? It's a very immediate answer will probably be no, but let's explore. And let me just introduce this terminology about the reported data. So N sub T, I am going to use to denote the variable which represent the fraction of daily reported infection. So this is also a fraction of daily reported new infections. T of T is fraction of reported active infection. So again, this is reported active infection. And R sub T is the reported recoveries. So again, this is a fraction of reported recovery. So again, this is known. And now these are fractions. So actual data that is available as a daily time series is this quantity multiplied by underlying population, which we just estimated to be rho times P naught. So we have T hat, RT hat, and NT hat available as daily time series. Now the question that we want to pose is, just like there was a linear relationship in between I, R, and N, some kind of linear relationship between I, R, and N in the SIR model, can we have a something similar between these three quantities? That if we can establish, it will be very good, because we know that these are the measured quantities, so we know their number. And that's where we make this hypothesis that these three, T hat, NT hat, and T hat plus RT hat times T hat, actually satisfy this linear relationship, very similar to what was true with the SIR model. I is 1 over beta N plus I plus R times I. I'm just writing hat for clearing the denominator. And here it says T hat equals B times NT hat plus some other constant E times this quantity. So except for the change in the constant, possibly, we postulate that this linear relationship holds. Well, that's a hypothesis. How do we verify this hypothesis? It's easy. We have the data, so we can verify. And I'm going to show you a bunch of data from India and Japan, which sheds lights on this hypothesis. And the way I'm going to show is that I'm going to plot T hat minus B times NT hat, this quantity, against T hat plus RT hat times T hat. And if the hypothesis is true, then these two points will lie on a line, I mean, the rather points generated by this for various time instants, will lie on a line passing through the origin with the slope E. And the value of B we choose carefully. So let's look at data. This is India data, March 23 to April 23, 2020. These points are those various time instant values of T minus Bn on the y-axis and T times T plus RT hat on the x-axis. Value of B, 3.86. Value of the slope is 39,164. And those who are familiar with linear regression, the R-square value of this fit on the line is 0.998.
Okay.
Right. Next. April 29 to June 20, this is about 60 points. B, 6.38, E come down dramatically to 917, R square value 0.999.
My God.
July 21st to August 21st. The same picture is happening everywhere. R square is very high. E is, if you notice the pattern, B keeps going up and down, but E keeps dropping. September to November, November 12th to December 31st. R square is like always 0.999. January 22nd to January 31st, March 28th to March 28th. And finally, April 24th to May 17th, the most recent one. All points beautifully lined up on a line. Also, notice there are some gaps here. Like this starts from April 24th, whereas this ends on March 28th. So there are intermediate points that I have skipped because they don't lie on a line. So if you look at the entire India timeline, about 62% of days satisfy that linear relationship. But of course, with different values of BNE. So I showed you 8 different pairs of values. And actually, there are 9 different pairs of values, which I refer to as phases. So 9 phases, each phase has a different value of BNE. Now, the question is, what really is happening? This kind of linear fit cannot happen by just a coincidence. Either somebody has to be sitting explicitly manipulating data to make sure that this fit is happening, or there is a natural phenomenon that is happening. But maybe, is it unique to India? No. We have simulated 26 countries, all states and union territories of India, and now more than 300 districts of India. Every single one of them shows the same property. So this indeed is a universal phenomenon that is happening, being reflected in the reported data from all over the world. So the question is, how does one explain this? Well, before I go into that, I just run through the Japan data, just in case some of you may think that India may be doing something. Here is Japan, February 19th to 24th March, R square 0.997. March 25th to June 14th, R square 0.998. June 20th, September 5, October, November, January and February. And this is the last one, March 31st to May 17th. Again, very similar structure. 64% of days on Japan satisfy this equation. Japan has 10 different phases. And one curiosity is that value of E for both India and Japan, if you look at phase one, starts very high. And it reduces dramatically and then kind of stabilizes. Not fully, but at least the reduction slows down. So this gives rise to the following question. Why does this equation hold for majority of days? Second, there are many days on which the equation does not hold. Why? And third, what is the meaning of these two values, B and E, and particularly E, which is dramatically changing? So these questions arise directly from the data, observed data. And this is explained very well by our model. And without going into the technicalities of our model, let me just show you the conclusions. What we show eventually, after we set up the differential equations like others, and we look at where is it? Yeah, these are the differential equations. We set it up and solve it. It turns out that it's very easy to solve. And what we conclude from that is that T is equal to some epsilon hat times U, where epsilon hat is another parameter, plus A times e to the minus gamma T. And this is a very decaying exponential. So within a short period of time, this goes to nearly zero. And we can say that U is converges to T by epsilon hat. Similarly, RU converges to RT by epsilon hat plus constant C, which is another parameter. So what this tells us is that T is what we see. And U is I should have gone through the sutra basic division. We divide the population into 4 categories. Susceptible, same as before. Infected are divided into 2 parts. Undetected, these are not tested positive. Tested positive, these are detected. And then they go to remote category. So U represents the size of undetected. T represents the size of tested positive. Now let's go back to this. So what the conclusion is that U converges to T over epsilon hat. So if we estimate, we know the size of T, rather T hat. So, and if you know epsilon hat, we can compute U. Similarly, if you know RT and epsilon hat and C, we can compute RU for all times. And moreover, just manipulating that new infection at any instant and estimating using the parameter equation, what we get is that T hat is equal to this is constant times NT hat plus this constant times T hat plus RT hat times T hat. And this is the fundamentals we call sutra of our model. That hypothesis of linear relationship between these three quantities is formally proven by our model. And this also tells us what these quantities B and E are. B is close to 1 over beta, then there is some other multiplication factor. And E is 1 over epsilon times rho times 1 minus C. So we have brought in more parameters here. In fact, now we have 6 parameters. Beta, gamma, eta from SIR model. And then epsilon is a new parameter, which is the ratio of detected to total infections. C is just a constant. Actually, you can just ignore it, assume it to be zero. And rho is the reach of the pandemic, the fraction of population over which the pandemic is active. And now, because these are all known quantities, we have the time series of T hat, NT hat, and this quantity. So just by using a standard linear regression, we can compute the value of B and E for all different phases. Why do phase changes occur? Well, because various interventions, lockdown or personal protection measures reduce contact rate, which is beta. Crowding and mutants increase contact rate. Testing policies change the epsilon value, because if you're testing a very large number, you will detect larger fraction of actual number. And remember that epsilon is the ratio of the detected with total number. Spread of infection to new areas increases rho. So these are all the reasons why the parameters values change. And when the parameter value changes, it's not reasonable to think that overnight it becomes a new value. There will be a few days of drifting from earlier value to the new value that will occur. So that's also very natural to assume that the parameter values, when there is a phase change, they drift for some time and then stabilize. And now we have answers to all the three questions. Our model shows why the equation holds for majority of days. And equation does not hold for some days because of that drift from one phase to another. And finally, the value of E is very large in the beginning, if you just recall what was E. Assuming C to be zero, E is just 1 over epsilon times rho. Now, when at the beginning of pandemic, the pandemic is on a very small fraction of population. So rho is very small. And that's why E is very large. As the pandemic spreads, the rho continuously increases and then kind of stabilizes to perhaps close to 1. And that's what it gets reflected in the stability of E. And there is this, although we can compute B and E, that still doesn't give us the value of beta, epsilon, rho, and C. Well, we have a fixed point based method, which we invented to compute the other parameter, all the parameter values. So with using this, we can estimate all the 4 parameter values. And these are the parameter values that you see for India, the 9 phases. And it tells us something interesting. Mind you, this is purely from data. We haven't gone to the ground, done any estimation. Just looked at the India data from COVID-19India.org, run our model on it, and pops these parameter values. Before lockdown, this is March 2020, contact rate was 0.33. Then after lockdown, it started reducing 0.26, 0.16, 0.16, 0.15 up to October. November festival season started climbing up 0.21, 0.22 up to February. Then February 10th, a drift started, and that drift continued for a long time. This is the time when the new mutant was spreading and people had started mixing also. The contact rate jumped up to 0.39. And then in April, some measures were applied, so it reduced to 0.33. I'll ignore the eta one. The gamma will fix to 0.1, not important. Now let's look at the last. You want to look at the last two columns. This gives the value of epsilon and rho. First, a caveat. Our model can compute all the parameter values for all phases except phase 1 epsilon value. And that we have to give as an external input to this, which we call calibration. So this is a calibration I have done with some understanding, but this not necessarily the correct one. So, and this calibration determines all these values and all these values also. See, the actual values need to be taken with a pinch of salt. However, the progression of the values is certainly going to be independent of calibration. So that's what we should look at. First, epsilon has hardly changed, although this is, we have allowed it to be variable, but it hasn't changed at the India level. Second, the reach started and became, was very small until May. Then it jumped up very rapidly. And this corresponds to that river migration of workers to various parts of India. Then it again stabilized for an extended period and again started jumping up in the recent times. And particularly in April, it really jumped up. This corresponds to essentially the community transmission of the virus that has been happening. And well, these are the India plots. We have been projecting it out anyway. So we computed this on 29th April, the orange curve, and it just missed the actual peak by a small margin of 4 days. And on 25th April, already I had said that peak will be in somewhere between 4th to 8th of May. We have done this kind of simulation for, like I said, many countries. This is Japan. This is UP. All the states are done now. And this is a lot of districts are done. This is Kanpur district. One can look at more simulations on our website. Well, that's all I have. Thank you.
Well, it's fascinating. And especially of those for those who at least know a minimum of differential calculus. The let me now put it in some layman's questions.
Yeah.
Do you see this? You said I think perhaps in the middle of August you should be down to a 4,000 or some thousand or 4,000. I don't know. So you gave some number in the very beginning. Is that so that by August we should be?
Yeah. This prediction, of course, has to be taken with certain caveats, which is what we do is we have computed the model, the parameter values for the current phase, which now we use to project the trajectory in future. Now, for we have been observing it, the trajectory, and like I showed you that plot in the last phase for India, perfectly lined up on a straight line. Yeah. And it continues to be. So as long as it continues to be there, this our projection will be nearly correct. I have no doubt in my mind. No. But if things change on the ground, suppose people suddenly start declare victory and start meeting each other, partying, then contact rate will jump up. Or if there is a new mutant which starts running through the the
new
population.
New election meeting, for example.
Yeah, some these things are. I mean, I cannot predict, and our model cannot predict. Uh-huh. So that's a caveat I want to say.
Right. So one first prediction you made, you scored 100% success. Middle of May. Well, okay. Now, what's your next prediction?
Next prediction. So I can certainly predict, and I don't see that going to change dramatically, is that by June end, our cases will drop very significantly to less than 20,000 cases a day. And that much I am reasonably confident. But beyond that, it's like too far out in the future to make a prediction. Regarding further, real future, like people talk about third wave. What needs to be, what's our estimate is that the second wave has been so massive that by the time it winds up in July, it will leave a very large fraction of population immune, having been infected and recovered. That immunity is not going to be forever. What the studies show is that the immunity lasts between 3 to 8 months. So that means 3 months takto everybody remains immune more or less. And then slowly some people start losing immunity. So up to, I would say, October, we are reasonably, we'll be safe from any third wave. Unless there is, of course, such a mutant comes who bypasses all immunity, then all bets are off. But so far that hasn't happened. Then if by that time, and there are projections for the vaccination level and so on, that from August it will increase dramatically. And the numbers that I have seen, if we manage to achieve those numbers, and the numbers that basically are saying that we can estimate, easily vaccinate 60 crore of population by this year end, if we can do that. And again, people's cooperation will be required, because I know a lot of people think that, there's vaccination will lead to death or impotency or whatnot. So if people cooperate, 60 crore get vaccinated, I would say 10, 20, 15 crore will carry forward their natural immunity. So we will really be in a good position. I don't think third wave that comes. It will come, of course, third wave will come, no doubt. But its impact will not be very high.
So vaccination, you think, is crucial for this?
Vaccination is absolutely crucial. Otherwise, see, natural immunity is not going to last forever. That much is clear. And after the first wave, also our estimate was, and all the data was also suggesting that, that a fairly good fraction of population is immune. So we had, based on that, we thought that perhaps the immunity will last, because by that time the data was also not there about how long does the immunity last. But it looks like by March, a lot of people had lost their immunity, and that's why the second wave was so drastic.
Before I go to show some graphs to you and ask your interpretation, I have one more question which I get Keith asked, so I better ask you. Are we going to now shift to a new normal, or the old normal can come back?
I think the old normal cannot come back fully, at least for next year or so. Once we establish that the vaccines provide long-term immunity, which we don't know yet, then we can probably go back to old normal, yes.
Ramesh, will you bring out that thing about the country, number of countries, the countries graph? No, not this one. That first one, not this one yet. This will be the second one. First one. No, this first one you showed it and then you removed it. Yeah. Professor,
yeah.
You see that United States is still number one as of May 21st, 2021.
Yeah.
And as a ratio of proportion, it's much ahead of India.
Yeah.
Even India aggregate is lower than United States as of May 21, 2021. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And course, proportion wise, I think India will be below even Russia.
Hmm.
Why is it that we got such a bad press?
Well, okay. So, I mean, I think the reasons are quite clear to everyone that there are always some people who want to use or sell bad news about India. And I feel rather strongly about it. I have no problem. If there is actually genuine bad news and you are in that business, please do that. But don't manufacture things out of in a way that sort of is not logical. Here is what. So there have been everywhere the whole world says, oh, India has underreported the number of deaths by a factor of 10. All sorts of factors have been thrown around. Okay, here is my argument. And I would request anybody here to, you know, refute it or educate me if I'm wrong. Let's assume that the deaths were underreported by a factor of 10. Now, but this phenomenon, that is underreporting of death by a factor of 10, is localized in both time and space. That is, if I take a city, take Delhi. Now, there was a period perhaps of 10-15 days when the deaths were being underreported by a factor of 10. Today, they are not being underreported by a factor of 10. So if you look at the entire timeline, there is a small window of days where this large underreporting happens. Similarly, if you look at space, look at whole country at one time instant and see where are the hotspots where such underreporting is happening, you will find a few hotspots. But India is a huge country. So when you sum over the time and space or integrate over time and space, this underreporting factor comes down dramatically. It will not remain 10x, it not even be close to 10x.
Yes.
So that kind of simple analysis is missing in our discourse.
Yes. Okay. Ramesh, the next one. Yes. Professor, see, what you notice is out-of-pocket spending for each Indian is almost 60%. And countries like Indonesia is less than 40%. The world is less than 20%. Now, doesn't this reflect somewhat on our health system?
Yeah, this data certainly shows that we need to improve our health system, because if such a large fraction of spending is done by our individuals and a lot of our people are not very well to do, so then for them this can really be a challenge, and I think we need to really step up here. Absolutely.
So, in the sense that the government, let's look at the next slide, please. Look at the healthcare spending.
Mm-hmm.
This is both state and center. Huh?
Mm-hmm.
And you find that it was in the year 2002 or 2001 a little over 4.2% of GDP. And then it comes sharply down, and a little peak at 3.7, and again it starts going down. And it's only till 2018. If you go down to a little more, say to 2021, or to a budget of 20-21, that is the financial year 2021, it's down to 3.1%.
Mm-hmm.
So, if you look at other nations, I have not seen many of the more important nations, so-called emerging nations, less than 5%. So one explanation would be, I assume that we have been underspending at the government level on health. Would that be correct?
Yeah, if that is the case. But I would say there is a bigger problem here. Let's take, we spend 3%, but are we spending that money well? You know, there is such, at state level, there is so much mishandling of that money. I know that state hospitals do get their budget. It's not that they are totally starved of money. They get money to buy stuff. They get money to treat patients. But are they really making good use of it? And I can see a stark example. I won't take names, but there are two state-run hospitals. One has a director who is very proactive, and the other one is not so. And this proactive director has really changed the looks. I mean, you go to the lobby of that place and you find, hey, am I in a government hospital? No, it's a really very nicely structured. No, nothing expensive there, but clean, spacious. There are doctors available all the time. No, there is good care. So it's with the same amount of money. So that's where I think there is a bigger problem.
True. Would you venture an opinion? I don't want to drag you into politics, but would you venture an opinion that at least for the next 20 years, the Constitution should be amended to transfer health from the states to the center? Right now, center is not a center. Of course, has peripheral things like All India Medical Institutes and so on. But in terms of hospitals, nursing homes and so on, it's done at the state level. And now with this kind of pandemic coming, do you think that for the next 20 years there should be a total central running of these basic hospitals and in terms of preparing for the future?
I'm not sure, frankly, because that will may centralize things a little too much, and controlling some everything from Delhi may not be so easy also.
What about concurrent list? Center can and state can also.
Okay. No, so I would say a better model could be that there could be a national authority or health authority or something, and all states and center join that and collectively, and they formulate policies as one group, instead of everybody doing their own things in a different way. It's a utopian thought, but if it can get implemented, it will be very nice.
I'm a member of the Standing Committee of Parliament on Health, and this is precisely what I suggested.
Okay.
That there should be a joint operation instead of, center doing one thing and the state doing another thing. And I think for at least 20 years, India needs to have that kind of a cooperative approach.
That is certainly, we need that. Absolutely.
Next slide, please. Now you see, in terms of spending, per capita spending in India, in terms of US dollars, is lower than even countries like Cabo Verde, Honduras, Morocco, and so on. Isn't this a shame on our country?
Per capita spending on health, is that right?
Okay. Yes. Health is on the second table.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is certainly, it's quite low. Yeah, I agree with that. And I think that certainly needs to be stepped up. I think what this pandemic has shown is that, look, I don't buy this argument, and some seem to be making that, we need to have so many hospital beds and ICU beds that everybody should be taken care of. It's impossible. I mean, if you have create that many beds, then in normal times, 90% will be empty. So it is just really totally impractical. However, what we certainly cannot accept is that something as basic as oxygen is not available in hospitals. I think that's a shame.
That's right. And that's really surprising because commercial institutions have enough. In fact, I think the requirement for commercial institutions is much more high quality oxygen than for medical, I'm told. So it's really surprising that we don't have arrangement. Seems to have been an administrative breakdown here more than anything else. Anyway, Doctor, sorry to put you through these questioning, but these are questions I had received by email. So I thought I'd put it together and for the audience sake, bring it out because everybody is concerned about the future. And you have given us both cause for hope, and you have given us a backing which is mathematically sound. So as far as I'm concerned, I feel questions are Jagdish and Ramesh, do you have any questions?
I have a question, but in the model, Professor Agarwal, in when you published the paper back in February, you had the first wave was declining. So what contributed to the sudden jump? I mean, such a dramatic jump in the second wave. When you created that model, were you anticipating the second wave to be this dramatic?
No, we were not. In fact, right up to March, we were projecting. We saw that second wave is coming. But our projection was it will be of the similar intensity as the first wave. And we also got that it will peak by end April or sometime. Now, the timing we got correct already in March, but the height we did not get. We got off by a factor of 4. And that's because, our calibration was off. The model calibration that I mentioned, the initial value of epsilon, first phase that we have to set. We calibrated it using a certain sero survey data by ICMR. Now, it turns out either that was, or actually possibly a combination of factors. One, that calibration was not precise enough or good enough. Second, many people lost immunity. And that was not built into the model. The reason it was not built into the model was that we had really no data. So we were flying blind there. So we did not know when people lose immunity. So it's now that there are some research done, we have a better idea. But we still, ideally, if we have reinfection data for the country, that is, till date, so many cases of reinfections have been found. That would really help us in underestimating what percentage of population has lost immunity.
As a follow-up question onto that, because one of the things that post-February, one of the reasons we're given is all these elections. So does your model take into consideration the super spreader events? Is that a variable that you can introduce into a model, or is that something that you have no control over?
No, we have not. Right now, our model does not have this kind of variables. It's a delicate game that we play here. One can bring in more and more parameters and more variables into the model. It's easy to insert them. The problem is that as you bring in more variables, there are more parameters whose values you have to estimate. And the more parameters you have to estimate, more likely is it that you will go wrong in some estimation or the other.
Okay.
Then your whole prediction may go off. So one has to, I agree that absolutely, there is by no stretch of imagination is our model perfect. It can certainly be improved upon. I'm sure it will be improved upon. But this is the basic one. And the key thing in our model, which I sort of failed to emphasize earlier, is that our is the first model that shows that the data is extremely useful in estimating parameters. Till now, parameters were being estimated using all kinds of other methods. We show by using reported data, you can actually estimate parameters and reasonably well. So that is something that I think going forward, this paradigm hopefully will get more and more adoption. And people will then start with our model, add new things, improve it, and make it better. There is certainly one part where our model can do with improvement is that there is a drift period that I talked about. In the beginning of phase, the parameter values change. And so that's a part period when, if you are currently in that period, then we don't know what will be the eventual value of the parameters because they are drifting. So any prediction done at that stage is going to be off. Now, can one use advanced statistical methods by looking at how these values are drifting to also estimate where they will stabilize? So if that can be done, then the predictability power of the model will improve.
Okay. The last thing is modeling vaccination as impact. So let's say, for example, like you said, vaccination is key. Would the R removed people be higher if the vaccination is low? So basically that model will also automatically adjust, correct?
Yeah. So we'll, modeling vaccination is not difficult. We just have our hands full right now. So I'm hoping that in June we'll have some time and we'll incorporate that.
Okay. Thank you. Arvindji?
No, Jagdish. Will come last. I'm sorry. Yeah.
No, Professor, some of our viewers have been asking how much information which you have obtained from government sources or from the data which is published, how far is this correct or near correct? So they want to know from the viewers' chat that on the data, although you did mention something, they are very keen to know whether the data has been underreported or what are those factors which you can please enlighten our viewers.
Yeah. So firstly, all our data is public. COVID-19India.org is where the data that we have used. Second, as I showed, the data is, of course, not capturing the real picture, no doubt. However, what it is showing is, it's not a random data. There is a very strong structure hidden. Otherwise, you won't have that kind of linear fits that it exhibits. And because of that, what we can conclude is that what we see is a scaled down version of the reality. And the scaling factor is that epsilon. So therefore, the actual curve that you see is what is the is roughly what is the real curve also. Only there is a scaling factor.
You mean what you're saying is, sorry for the interruption, Jagdish, but what you're saying is that the data you have divided by the true data, that's stable over your
That's right. Model. That's stable over time. Yes, that our model phase is stable, and our analysis of data also shows that it is stable.
That's perfectly justified in regression analysis. Yes, go ahead,
Arvind. Your question.
There is one.
Dr. Agarwal. I have many questions, but I'll briefly ask two questions. My first question is related to your earlier paper, which was published in Indian Journal of Medical Research, which was Success of Lockdowns. Now, the last table which you had shared with us just now, calculating the beta value over a period of time, and you had shown that beta value nationally was going down till about September, October, and then it picked up again. And it may be because of lack of immunity or maybe some other reason. Now, first of all, my question is, there are some states which went into elections. Is this the reason that we had a Kumbh Mela and we had elections in few states? The beta value going up, is it because of that? So this will also suggest the success or failure of the lockdown in different states. Number one. Number two, you can choose the order of answering. My second question relates to your prediction is for the current number of infections per day and the cumulative number of infections per day. Now, what about death rate? I was looking at the data this morning from Delhi state alone. Now, there is a complete correlation between the number of infections and the total number of infections going down the curve are moving in the same direction. But the death rate, number of people dying, is not correlated with the number of people who are infected. In fact, there's a time lag of about 10 days if you look at the movement of the graph. So how can we incorporate this value and predict the death rate?
Oh, let me just show you. I'll take you the first, second question first. Let me show you. We can estimate death rate also. Can I share the my screen?
Yes, go ahead. You have to do it again. Just go click on share.
Okay. And you can do it. Okay. Okay. Let's share a window. India. Okay. Just look at this plot. The blue line is the actual death curve, cumulative death curve of India as reported. And the orange line is what is predicted by our model. So we can come, we can catch it reasonably well. And on our estimate, we should end up somewhere between about 3.7, 3.8 lakh deaths at the end of this.
So you're seeing a substantial jump or an exponential.
Big jump. There's a big jump here. That's what we are currently going through. And that is... going to keep rising.
So the number of cases are going down, but the number of deaths is going up.
This is mortality.
That's going up. Yeah, mortality. This is like by until mid of June, this will keep, there'll be a substantial number, yes.
This is important, very important. Arvindji, there is one question, more of a technical in nature from one of
I think there was a part one of the question.
Yeah, part one. Let's take the part one of the question, okay. Which was, can you please remind me? The lockdown, the elections in lockdown. You know, every single state of India in March-April time period has reported a significant jump in beta. Every single state, whether it had elections or not. So, I think elections would have played a role, but I do not see them playing a big role. Or similarly for Kumbh Mela also. So this was really due to two factors. One, this double mutant, which is faster spreading. And two, I think most important factor, that people just threw caution to the winds. I know about Kanpur, and I'm sure these are the stories were valid everywhere. The malls were overflowing. People were just lining up for, Starbucks and this, et cetera, without any mask, nothing. And that time, there were already reports that this some mutant is there, was spreading fast in Maharashtra. But nobody was caring. It was like, oh, Maharashtra mein hoga, it won't happen here.
So, okay, one technical question. So you can quickly read it. It's on the screen.
Yeah.
So I didn't want to go through the whole thing.
Oh goodness. No, I don't think P is equal to NP. I think P is not equal to NP.
Okay.
Twin prime hypothesis is still unsolved, yes. When will Riemann hypothesis be solved? Well, okay. If I could guess that, then there'll be something. It doesn't look to be anytime soon because such statements are often fraught with danger, but there are not good enough, let's say, directions we know right now to solve Riemann hypothesis. Of course, somebody can anytime come, or some young genius can come up with a radically different ways and solve it. That's always possible. It often happens in math.
Yeah, it has happened once in history in 1966. So, right, Dr.
Yeah, it's happened many times.
I'll have one more very small question.
Yeah.
One more very small question. And that question is... when we do the regression analysis, R square is extremely high. 0.9 is almost, in real data, it is very rare. But when we do the spatial analysis for different states or zones, Don't you think density as a variable is also very important? For example, in Mumbai, if we talk about, then maybe areas like Dharavi and all that, the spread will be much faster.
Yeah.
As compared to, let's say, cities which are having less density, number one. How different is your model from the model given by Bramar Mukherjee of University of Michigan?
So the first question, you are very right that density plays a crucial role, and that gets reflected in the beta value. So when we compute beta for Mumbai versus beta for another district, which is like primarily rural, there is a significant difference in the beta values for the same reason as you pointed out, that there's a much larger, faster spread happening in big cities, dense cities, than open areas. So that's how we don't explicitly incorporate, but it gets reflected into the parameter values. Secondly, this model by Bramar Mukherjee. See, this is a traditional model. What they use is SIR kind of a model with four categories, where they were undetected and detected ones, or asymptomatic and symptomatic ones, and they make the difference is that in her model, like all other models, they make educated guesses about the parameter values. Whereas we make no guesses. We let data dictate the parameter values.
Okay.
So that's a big difference.
Okay. One more question. One from Pramod. Pramod, your question is valid, but in spite of having three doctors on the show, none of them are medical doctors. So we really cannot answer this question. So, but it is valid. But, you know, it is very difficult to say what is making this thing happen. Is another question, Professor, this, how is the model predicting the death numbers? Are we looking at certificates issued?
No, we look at the daily reported death data.
On the COVID-19.
Again, it's available in COVID-19 India.
Okay. Jagdishji, any other questions?
No.
Okay. Dr. Swami, any questions from your end?
No. He has answered them all very well. Even though it is, for him, a layman's question, but still, there's a lot of interest in knowing the answers to that, and he has answered it perfectly.
Yeah, the only concern I see, Professor Agarwal, is this death rate spike, you know, which is, how do we cope? I mean, is this death rate spike across states, or is that, I mean, even though you predicted it from a nation, from whole nation standpoint, but is that spike going to be the same? Is that curve going to be the same almost, you know?
Curve is going to be broadly same. Yeah, so shifted in time, of course, different state, different time periods, but
yeah,
broadly
the same. Why is the peak shifting between Tamil Nadu and Andhra? Why is it different?
It's that's something which is worth investigating. I do everything sitting in my closed room in front of a computer. So I have no idea about the ground reality. I only report what that data is telling me. Now the question is, why is it that it went late? In fact, for Tamil Nadu, I should also share, the beta value hasn't increased as much as in many other states.
Wow.
Which seems to suggest that this mutant doesn't seem to be playing a big role
in Tamil Nadu.
Until recently in Tamil Nadu.
Mm.
It could be some other reason also. I have really no idea. I'm doing is reporting, and I'm hoping that those who are on the ground can corroborate it with the real picture, that exactly what happened there.
So an epidemiologist can take your data and actually do a lot more,
That's right.
Analysis.
That's right. In fact, there is a big project I have embarked upon, which is to simulate all districts of India. It is halfway done. And if once we complete it, the data we'll generate will be exceptionally useful because, you know, for example.
You can leave your mic down, Professor Agarwal. I think we're good. Oh. I mean, yeah. Okay. Yeah,
one can trace exactly which district this double mutant started from, because there will be a spike in beta at that month. And then how did it spread? How did this spike in beta travel across the country?
Mm. Because it's very strange. In the US, when we looked at the Northeast, if you look at New York, Pennsylvania, New Jersey, Connecticut, the curves were pretty much, they were very aligned in the sense that, you know, the spike cases, everything were all these four or five states, what we call tri-state area or this four-state area and all were same. But it was definitely different from what's happening in the West, South, or even the Midwest. But in India, it's very strange that between Andhra and Tamil Nadu, the peaks are different, which is like very strange behavior. Yes. Yes, sir.
I think we have taken a lot of his time.
Friends, we come to the end of a very interesting session which we had today on the COVID pandemic spread, catching the numbers. And as Professor Maninder Agarwal ji has put it, he has enlightened our viewers, and Dr. Swami's inputs and Dr. Swami's figures, I think our viewers have been enlightened by this knowledge which has been spread today in this program. We owe a big thank you to Professor Agarwal ji and Dr. Swami for educating our viewers on a very important aspect and explaining very scientifically what all has gone into getting these figures right. So we come to an end of another episode on on Words of Wisdom, Gyan Ganga, our Sunday show. We'll be back, as you all know, on a Saturday, Words of Wisdom, that is Economic Words of Wisdom, Arth Gyan Ganga, on next Saturday at 8 p.m. I wish to thank my co-host Ramesh Swami and Professor Arvind Chaturvedi from Delhi for helping us put this program together. I also have to thank our technical team led by Ashish Shetty, Tejas Navalgul, Gadgi Rakesh, Ishwar Iyer, Swaminathan and Vishal Mehta for their valuable inputs and behind the scene activities of having, getting this program and the other infrastructure in place, technical team together, and for spreading these words of wisdom, Gyan Ganga, to our viewers. Definitely our viewership is growing across the globe in numerous countries, and we thank our viewers for their support. You can always go to our website www.vhsindia.org and register yourself as members, and even go to YouTube to see our past episodes on the Virat Hindustan Sangam channel. You'll get all our past episode lectures, talks, our guest speakers and all that, which is very useful for people who want to watch this at leisure, because some parts of the globe is sleeping now, but still they come and see our shows on YouTube. You can always access it. With these words, I'm thanking you all. Jai Hind, Dhanyavad.